Team Albertus Magnus wishes you a very warm good evening. We continue the coverage of Marico with a buy rating and investment returns of 8% and 23% by March 2012 and 2013 respectively over the current average price of 147 rupees. This is because of the strong sales growth both in value and the volume terms, impressive growth in the rural markets and acquisition of the strong brands in the growing regions. The results are subdued because of the losses in the Kaya business and volatility of the input prices. The current H1 results are in line with our projected values. The stock movement of the Marico has outperformed the BSE FMCG sector, which in turn outperformed the BSE Sensex. This is because of the advantages that Marico has, which we would be covering in the coming slides. The INR 31 billion rupees business of the Marico can be segregated into three divisions of Indian consumer business, which can be segregated into coconut hair oil, value-added hair oil, and the Saffola functional foods region. The international consumer business, consisting of healthcare, hair care, and the personal care, which is based outside India. And the Kaya business, consisting of Kaya India, Kaya Mina, and the Derma RX, which are mainly into the skin care. These are few of the brands of the Marico. Company is shifting its focus from the coconut oil centric business to a well diversified portfolio of beauty and wellness offerings, which can be seen from the expected 2016 pie chart. This is in line with the company's strategy of leveraging the strong brand equity power via organic and inorganic growth by introducing new and new products in the regions having higher margins. Now let's see the advantages that Marico has. Marico has a strong brand equity power with almost all its brands being the market leaders, which is being leveraged by prototyping across the variants and by the brand extension under the current names. Marico is diversifying internationally by acquiring the niche products in the growing regions, which are either market leaders or the market challengers. Marico's acquisition strategy in the regions is in the regions of low category penetration, low competition intensity, unorganized distribution system, and the scope for the potential growth. Marico is continuously increasing its top line by cross-selling of the products, which can be seen by the orange lines marked there, and by continuously targeting the potential regions. As per our research, in the future, the Marico's potential target regions could be the regions marked in green. The current 11% of the Indian middle class is expected to be 30% by 2020 and 40% by 2030. Marico is focusing on the northern regions along with the western and the southern India because of the high urbanization rates that are expected to be in the coming years. Saffola is evolving as a healthcare brand while Kaya is repositioning to attract more and more customers. The rural people are now focusing more towards the non-food items expenditure because of their increasing income. Marico can tap this force to derive 35% of the market share by 2013. Marico is also focusing on the next 11 countries which are marked pink here because these are the potential growth regions after the BRIC countries. This is as per the Goldman Sachs report. Marico has brand leaders in its portfolio and has some intelligent pricing strategies due to which it is able to transfer the price rise to the customers without sacrificing on the revenues.
Now let's discuss some of the concerns that Marico has. Saffola derives a major portion of its revenue from edible oil. Now during a primary research, we found out that the functional food category, the shelf space is not being properly used, resulting into poor visibility. Now, another concern is that Marico management structure is very much growth conductive, but there is no immediate successor for Mr. Harsh Mariwala, which can be a cause of concern for the company. Now, moving on to financial analysis, upon benchmarking Marico's financial with its peers, we found out that EBITDA margins are on the lower side, and because of the commodity nature of the coconut oil business, and the debt to equity ratio is on the higher side, resulting into lower PAT margins. Now we are expecting a CAGR growth of 15% of the sales, mainly driven by hair oil, Saffola and international business categories. For coconut oil, we are expecting that the company will be able to gain market share from unbranded player, resulting into a CAGR of around 7%. Hair oil category is expected to grow with a CAGR of 20% with Parachute prototyping in South India and light hair oil category growth in North India. For Saffola, we are expecting that the food brands will be able to gain traction beyond 2013 and a CAGR of around 18%. For Kaya, we are expecting that after repositioning an 11% CAGR with higher capacity utilization and increased product sales. Now, talking about margins, we are expecting a 200 basis point rebound in the margin by 2013, mainly driven by lower prices of commodities and margin improvement in international business. Free cash flow to sales ratio is expected to improve to 4% by 2016 on the account of higher sales and cash generation. ROE is expected to stabilize around 25 to 26%. Now, in absence of any major acquisition, we are expecting that debt to equity ratio will fall in line with the industry standard. Now, moving on to valuation. To calculate cost of debt, we have taken the appropriate weightage of foreign and domestic debt for the company. We have employed CAPM model to calculate cost of equity and also taken into consideration country risk premium. WACC comes out to be 9.64%. For free cash flow valuation, we have employed three methods, that is enterprise DCF, APV model and economic profit model. By giving appropriate weight to each model, we come out at a valuation of Rs. 162 per stock. We have employed three-stage growth model for the company, and the major part of the growth is coming from the stable growth phase.
Looking at the relative valuation of the company, as Marico's product strategy is largely different from its competitors, we've segregated the competitors into three broad spectrum. One is close competitors, distant competitors, and broad-based FMCG companies. For benchmarking purposes, we have selected companies which have similar margins as Marico and a similarly strong brand franchise. We've selected Dabur, Imami, HUL, and P&G for relative valuation purposes. Since the inception of the inorganic growth strategy of Marico, Marico's share price has been trading at 16 to 25 times 1 year forward earning. When we see the benchmark companies, their average is also around 22.76 as of now. We give a 5% premium to Marico because of its geographical diversification as well as the better growth prospects, and we find the target price of Marico at 156. The same using EV by EBITDA multiple comes at around 156 as well. Giving a 60-40 weightage to free cash flow and relative valuation, we find that the price of Marico is around 160 per share. Now let us look at various risks involved with the company. We've segregated the risks on the basis of their likelihood of occurrence and the impact on balance sheet. And the major risks are long gestation periods of the new items that Marico has been throwing in the market. Second and most important is the increase in raw material prices due to global scenario. We did a volatility analysis of these risk factors to get the quantitative impact of them using Monte Carlo simulation. We found that a terminal EBITDA margin is one of the most important risk factors for this company, closely followed by the terminal growth of the company. Whereas the international business growth and Kaya skin growth are relatively benign risks. For measuring the impact of currency fluctuations on the stock of the company, we created an index, a weighted index of the currencies in which Marico operates. We found that the long-term fluctuations have been very low vis-a-vis the rupee of this index. Marico's currency exposure can be because of two factors. One is the US dollar and rupee fluctuation, which can cause a higher debt and interest payments. Second is because of the subsidiary currency and rupee fluctuation, which can result in lower realized growth. In our base case, which was taken 2-3 months back, we got the price of Marico at 162. Since then, Marico's Indian currency has depreciated by 18 to 20% for the US dollar and 10% vis-a-vis the index that we had created. And we found that both these factors have negated the effect of each other, and the share price, target share price still remains at 162. The Altman Z score for Marico has been consistently been above the threshold limit of 3. And for most of the constituent ratios in this factor, Marico performs better than the industry.
We did a corporate governance study of the company to get to find the sustainability of this growth. We found that Marico's corporate governance structure is relatively well placed, barring a few negatives. For example, Marico has more non-executive directors than stipulated in the board. It also has more more non-executive directors in the auditors audit committee, etc. We did a CSR in comparison of Marico with the comparable companies on the basis of the UN guidelines. We found that Marico still has some room on this front. Now, to sum it up, we feel that Marico has great growth prospects in the long run, and in the short run there can be positive surprises due to lowering of input prices. Hence, we give a buy rating to this company with a target.
One small thing, you know, you mentioned that Marico had lower EBITDA margins and higher debt equity ratios and lower ROEs compared to the peers. But when you do the valuation analysis, you have taken an average of the peer group to value Marico. What was the rationale for that?
Sir, first, basically, it was more geographical diversification for Marico. Second, the growth that we see of the peers, it has been around 10-odd%. HUL, PNG have been our mature players in the Indian market, whereas Marico has been expanding overseas as well as in India. Hence, we see Marico has a higher growth prospects than the peers.
You have the last 5 years' average growth for the various companies to make that statement.
So Marico has grown to triple of its size revenue from 11 billion. Now it's a 31 billion company. So we can expect that a CAGR of around 15-20% of that. So it's a very good growth, and the given the direction in which company's business is moving, we can expect similar growth for the next 4-5 years.
But that is not how you have valued the company, right?
There has been a shift since the past 2-3 years, and Marico has been selling the brands which are not making high margins. So last year it sold off Swikar brand, which was low margin product, and similarly Sil was sold off some years back. It is consistently entering into markets which have higher margin, like the Kaya business or even the Safola business. So that is how we feel that going forward it should get the multiples that the other companies enjoy.
As the commodity-based nature of the company is changing into more towards more value addition, like in the hair oil category, it's moving towards more value-added products, and Safola is also a value-added product for the company. So we can expect, I mean, we have been seeing the EBITDA margin improvement consistently over last 3-4 years. And for next 5 years, we can expect that EBITDA margin will improve with that. And the pricing strategy of the company is also fairly good to keep EBITDA margins.
Okay, my question is, looking at your P band chart which you put, the multiple right now is probably the highest in the last 8 to 10 years. So a lot of the good thing what is being talked about is probably priced in, right? What is incrementally going to change to make this such an expensive company still a buy from your perspective in terms of being able to hold valuations or improve? Incrementally, what is changing in the company's strategy or growth?
Sir, first foremost is the increase in the cash flow, that we see the band themselves are increasing. So going forward, it will again come back to 25 times. It is already entered 25 zone. And we have the cash flow in the coming years is going to be very good according to our estimates. And hence, it will be going forward, it will go back to the zone in which it operated.
Moreover, sir, the company made a couple of acquisitions in 2010 and 2011, which are yet to give dividends to the company. We see the company's Kaya business was making losses. However, they occupied Dharma RX in 2010, which has resulted into 22% EBITDA margin for the company. And as a result, due to the changing business mix and due to the acquisitions that are yet to give value to the company, we expect the company will post higher EBITDA margins and better growth prospects than other companies. That is why we expect the company will trade at around 24 times their 1 year forward earnings.
But why should higher cash flow result in better PE?
Sir, our estimates of profits is very low this year because the margins have been less as the raw material prices have been varying a lot this year. But going forward, we see that the raw material prices are going to decrease or stabilize at some level. And so Marico will have pricing power which will enable it to stabilize its margins, and that those will be higher.
Okay, thank you. Other questions.
Also, sir, at the same time, Marico is moving towards premium pricing health products, which are actually more premium priced. So it will actually gain. For example, Saffola, they have extended into Saffola cholesterol management products, Saffola Arise, Saffola Salt is there, which is into more into premium priced products. So their margins will improve at the same time, sir.
Premium because the Marico's products are basically, most of the products are innovative. That is, they don't have any competitors in that. As we see, Marico, the Saffola Arise, which is the rice that don't make you lazy. There is no such rice in the market. Then the cholesterol control atta mix, which is not there in the market of any other brand. So Marico has some differentiated products on which it can charge the premium.
What is the sales growth you're assuming?
Sir, we have assumed the sales growth of around 15% for the 15% sales growth we have assumed for the company. And for various categories, we have assumed different growth according to the stage in which they are. Like the
next 3 years, what is the sales growth?
14 to 15.
Didn't Marico give up a growth warning recently? I mean, have you factored that in? Yeah. I mean, Marico made a public announcement that. Of
44% sales growth. We have factored that.
No, company had said that they may not be able to achieve the targets that are set by the analyst. However, in the first half, if we see, the company has expanded by around 33%. That was due to the volume as well as value growth. So we have factored that into our calculations, and we have given conservative estimates for the growth of the company.
So you think at this level of growth, the stock is obviously undervalued?
We expect around 20% of upside in next 15 months.
All right. The one thing I didn't see in your analysis was, you know, for an FMCG company, you need to know what advertising is as a cost. You know, it's obviously a most important benchmark to look at.
In general, they spend around 13% of their sales on advertisements. However, due to the higher input costs, they have reduced their A&P spend to around 9.5% in this first half year.
To what percent?
Around 9.5% in the first half year. However, in the countries they have expanded, like in Egypt, they are spending a lot of money on that on their A&P, and this is why, due to which, they were able to achieve a higher growth than the industry in Egypt and other overseas markets. And in future, the company has said that if the margins are hit, they will maintain an A&P spend around 11% of their sales. So we expect when the company reposition itself into the Kaya business and expands into the overseas market, they will spend a little more on the A&P spend. And that is what we have taken into our projections in the future.
No, so it's gone from 14% to 9% advertising expense? No,
generally, for industry, it's around 13%. But for company maintain, it's around, a company has given directions that they will maintain it at around 11% if their margins are hit due to higher input costs.
Also, they are using the advertising spend more judiciously, actually, for Parachute, they are spending more into the distribution network in the rural areas. For Kaya, they have stopped the TV advertising. Now they are more looking forward to the newspaper advertising or the local advertising. And for Saffola, actually, they are spending more on the TV. So in that way, effectively, I mean, they are producing more return out of their advertising spend in this manner.
Do you question management's wisdom? We are such a big domestic market, as you pointed out yourself, it's going to become so big. Why are they wasting management time, bandwidth, energy to go overseas and spud these brands? Why not focus on the domestic market? Is that a rational strategy?
So one of the key risks to this kind of business is that preferences of people are changing. So whenever Marico is going into another market, they are capturing brands which are into slightly different products. So there can be a lot of cross-selling of those products among countries. They can be introduced in India as well. So it can be a great hedge against the changing sentiments, changing preferences of the people, one. And the countries in which Marico has been now investing in are a part of the N11 countries that Goldman Sachs came up with. So these are the countries which after BRICS are going to grow as fast as the BRICS did 10 years back. So so the volume growth in these countries is going to be phenomenal, as India had in the past one decade. So that is why Marico is investing in these countries.
But do you think the growth is over in India, so it's rational for management to go overseas? In terms of your investment rationale, do you think the growth in India is tapering off? so that they should go abroad. Is that a correct strategy?
So growth in India is not tapering, firstly, but the products in which Marico is like the hair oil business, coconut oil business, it is fairly saturated. Okay. And it needs to go into sectors like hair cream, also the things that they have acquired like skin creams and all. These are the things of the future. So they need those products in their portfolio for one. And the market for these products in India will grow at a faster rate than the hair oil market in India.
They wanted to increase the product sales products in that. So rather than spending on their products, they had to establish, so they went to the Singapore and acquired DermaRx from there. Now they are, DermaRx is already a very much proven company. So its products are, and it is being, we can see it in the for the first half of this year, and it has shown tremendous growth in that.